Welcome to the third video in our series about the C2000 Digital Control Library. In this video, we will take a brief look at the data loggers in the library. Data loggers allow a stream of data to be captured in a buffer for later examination or use. The DCL contains three types of data logger: single-channel data loggers for the 32-bit fixed point, 32-bit floating point, and 64-bit floating point CPUs, multi-channel data loggers for the 32-bit fixed point and 32-bit floating point CPUs, and a transient capture module for the 32-bit floating point CPU. There are also functions to analyze transient response from a servo error captured using the TCM. In this video, we will only explore the single-channel data logger running on the FPU32. Once this is understood, the user will find it straightforward to apply any of the other loggers with reference to the DCL user's guide. This slide shows the header file dependency for data loggers. As before, header files are shown in white and source files in yellow. The generic library header file dcl.h is included in the single-channel data logger header file for each CPU. Since we are interested in the FPU32 single-channel data logger, we need only include the file dcl_fdlog.h. The assembly file dcl_fdlog.asm contains routines to speed up reading and writing data to the buffer. Use of these functions is optional, but recommended. The basic concept in the DCL data logger is that in order to represent and access a linear data buffer, you need three pointers: one to define the first address in the buffer, one to define the last address in the buffer, and one to index into the buffer to read or write data. The three pointers are encapsulated in a structure type named FDLog. To add a data logger to existing code, the user would perform these steps. First, declare a buffer of the desired size and use the data_section pragma to associate it with a string. Edit the linker command file to allocate a block of RAM to hold the data buffer and place the buffer there. An example of section placement is shown in the top right of the slide. Next, declare an instance of the data logger, initialized with the default addresses. Now, initialize the DCL using the dcl_initlog function. This loads the buffer addresses into the data log pointers. At this point, the contents of the buffers can be zeroed or loaded with a defined value, if desired. All that remains is to read data from or write data into the data log. It will be necessary to add the assembly file dcl_fdlog.asm if using the accelerated functions. In this slide, we see a list of the data logger functions. The first six are concerned with initializing the data log, and the last four are functions to read and write to the buffer. The last two functions are the assembly functions from the file dcl_fdlog.asm. To conclude, let's review a simple code example where two data logs are configured to receive the contents of two ADC conversions. On the left, we see the code to declare and initialize the two data logs, as described previously. Our logs, named XBuf and YBuf, are both 1,601 elements in length, each element being a 32-bit float. At the bottom of the code section on the left, we are loading zeros into all the elements of XBuf and a specified floating point number into all the elements of YBuf. On the right, we see an example of an interrupt service routine which is triggered by an ADC end of conversion. The code reads two ADC channels and stores the results into our two logs. When the logs are full, the dcl_writelog function will simply wrap the data pointer back to the first address, so the buffer contains a continuous record of the last 1,601 data points. This concludes our video on DCL data loggers. In the next video, we'll look at the non-linear PID controller. Thanks for watching.